This presentation will give an introduction to laser diffraction. In this method, we investigate interaction of particle with light to derive its size. There are four different types of interaction between light and particles. Diffraction: light is diffracted from particle edge, and that's why it's called edge diffraction. Refraction: light goes through the particles, changing its angle and intensity. Reflection: when light hits the surface of the particles and reflects back. And adsorption: light is adsorbed within particle and can radiate as infrared heat. Out of these four interactions, diffraction and refraction gives us information about particle size. We do not use reflected or adsorbed light because they do not provide any useful information. So the particle is hit with a monochromatic light, and light is diffracted from its edge. This begins to create waves that overlap and create interference or diffraction pattern. You can see radiating lines, where black lines mean destructive interference of waves and bright lines constructive interference. From the diffraction pattern, we can derive size information. We can do this because angle and intensity of light depends on particle size. Larger particles scatter at more narrow angles, but scattered light much more intensely. Smaller particles scattered over a wider range of angles, but less intensely. So there is a fundamental relationship. Size of the particle is related to the angle of scattered light and also the intensity of the light. There are a few considerations that must be taken into account. Light must be collected over a large range of angles. Also, laser diffraction assumes a volume equivalent sphere model, where equivalent sphere is a sphere that diffracts light at the same angle as the particle of interest. Also, laser diffraction uses Mie theory to calculate particle size distribution by volume. Note that for the particles larger than certain size, the vast majority of light is scattered by diffraction. The certain size is determined as a multiple of the wavelengths of light used for the measurement and typically approximated at 20 to 50 microns. Particles larger than this size provide useful information through diffraction, but not refraction. This means we do not need a refractive index to accurately interpret refractive light. For particles smaller than 20 microns, refracted light becomes increasingly important, and the choice of refractive index will directly affect accuracy in this size range. Other things to consider when doing laser diffraction are sampling and sample dispersion. There are three main sources of errors: sampling, dispersion, and instrumentation. As you see from this plot, proper dispersion is very important in the smaller size range, while if you have larger particles or very wide particle size range, then sampling becomes progressively more important. Now let's go over what data are reported by laser diffraction and look into distribution statistics. The choice of the statistical parameter will depend on how data will be used and what they will be compared with. To report most common particle size in a distribution, we can choose between the following parameters: mean, its average size of the population; median, the size at which 50% of particles have smaller size; mode, size with the highest frequency. And for monomodal distribution, mean, mode, and median are all the same value. Other parameters that are often are reported are surface area, mean, D3-2. It is most relevant when surface area is important, for example, when you study reactivity, dissolution, or bioavailability, and it's most sensitive to the fine particles in size distribution. The volume moment mean d43 reflects the size of those particles which consisted the bulk of the sample volume, and it's more sensitive to the presence of larger particles in the size distribution. For volume-weighted particle size distribution, which are reported by laser diffraction, it is convenient to report parameters based upon the maximum particle size for a given percentage volume. These percentiles are reported as D values. For example, dV10 is equal to 13.5 micron. Here, D is diameter, V is distribution weighting by volume, it can be by number or intensity, and also 10 is percentage of sample below 13.5 micron. So it means that 10% by volume of your particles is less than 13.5 micrometers. And here you can see on the plot where we plot volume distribution and also cumulative distribution, we can find this d10, d50, and d90 values. This is commonly reported values for laser diffraction. To give some illustration of how particle size data are used, this plot shows size distribution by volume for three chocolate types: dark, milk, and white chocolate. You can see a node at 30 micron for milk and white chocolate, but not for dark. The change in the size of this node can be attributed to increasing amounts of sugar content from dark to milk and to white chocolate. D50 and D90 values show the increase in particle size in the same order, while D10 doesn't vary significantly between these chocolates. Since dark chocolate has smaller amount of these large particles, it appears to have a smoother, luxurious texture compared to other chocolates. Another chocolate study here at Penn State was focused on how chocolate perception depends on grinding times. Chocolate samples refined to different particle size. The goal was to minimize grinding energy without compromising chocolate quality. This plot shows that prolonged 8-hour grinding decreased the amount of larger particles, which affected chocolate grittiness. To summarize, the advantages of laser diffraction include very wide size range from nanometers to millimeters, excellent repeatability, the measurements are very fast, there are wet and dry dispersion accessories available. We don't need to calibrate instrument, but it's very easy to verify its performance by a standard. Disadvantages include the fact that optical properties for model are not always available, but we need to know refractive index for the particles. Also, the instrument gives you volume-based distribution, and we cannot calculate number-weight distribution without significant errors. For wide distribution, large volume of sample is required. Typical applications include ceramics, metals, biomaterials, soils and sediments, carbon materials, food products, to name a few. Here you can see specifications for our Malvern MasterSizer 3000 laser diffraction system we have at MCL, and you can look into more details on our website. If you have any questions, please contact me and visit our website if you want to submit training or analysis request. And I hope to work with you in the future.